Amen. Did you have fun like I did, brethren?
Yes.
I had fun with those hymns, brethren. You may be seated. I told you that we have a most wonderful service lined up for you today. After those beautiful hymns, our second thing on the agenda is going to be a special item by no other than Sister Kedeen Wright. Sister Kedeen and Sister Dolisha.
Happy Sabbath, everyone. From the beginning to the end, my whole life is in your hands. This whole world may hold me down, but it can never drown you out. I'm not merely flesh and bone. I was made for something more. You are God, you're the great I am. Breath of life, I breathe you in. Even in the fire, I'm alive in you. You are strong in my brokenness. Through the dark, I hear your voice. Rising up, I will rejoice. For I was lost, but now I'm found. 'Cause even death can hold you down. You are God, you're the great I am. Breath of life, I breathe you in. Even in the fire, I'm alive in you. You are strong in my brokenness, sovereign over every step. Even in the fire, I'm alive. I'm alive in you. I'm alive in you. It's no longer I who live, but Christ who lives within me. Christ who lives within me. From beginning to the end, you deserve the glory. You deserve the glory. It's no longer I who live, but Christ who lives within me. Christ who lives within me. From beginning to the end, you deserve the glory. You deserve the glory. You are God, you're the great I am. Breath of life, I breathe you in. Even in the fire, I'm alive
How was that church? That was indeed beautiful. Someone said sell off, which means that she did exceptionally well. So I'm hoping that our next presenter is going to sell off also. So without further ado, I now invite to the podium Deacon Bleary with today's sermonette.
That's a good one. That's a good one. I didn't expect that. I didn't expect that one bit. Thank you very much, everybody. Thank Ella George for having me here today. Thank you also. That I'm in your presence, thanks to great God for his blessing and mercy on all our lives. My topic today is showing I get claustrophobic. Faith that shows perseverance. What is perseverance? Perseverance is doing something despite the difficulties or delay in achieving the success. To succeed in faith, we must overcome the difficulties despite the fact that Jesus is not yet here. There are many challenges, there are many difficulties that we have to endure until he comes. We have a perfect example. Job overcome the difficulties and trial of this life. He's asleep. And he rests in the hall of faith, waiting for his return, for Jesus Christ to return with the kingdom. Jesus said in Matthew 6:9, the kingdom will come. This is assurance that we have that no matter what happens to us in our life, the challenges, the barrier, the setbacks, the kingdom will come. All we have to do is persevere until the end. Winston Churchill says, success consists of going from failure to failure without the loss of enthusiasm. We cannot lose that enthusiasm for faith. We cannot lose that enthusiasm when difficulties come. We have to stay focused until that day comes when either our eyes are shut or we hear the trumpet sound. Amen. What is faith? Hebrews 11:1 make it clear. Now faith consists in what we hope for, assurance about what we do not see. Our success is making it into the kingdom of God. Dependent, and that is dependent on our faith. Our faith has a great impact in how we make it there. Yes. Don't overlook that aspect of your walk, your journey. Faith in overcoming the challenges, in overcoming the difficulties. Persevere as the road gets rocky. Jesus, for us to have this salvation that we now share in Christ, Jesus had to persevere in the Garden of Gethsemane. Not my will, but thy will. We too have to have that will and perseverance to know that we have to make it. And it does not matter how much failure you fail, we have to make it. However, there are three types of faith. We have three types. The first type of faith is a doctrinal faith. You ever meet somebody in the church and they can spew off doctrine off the top of their heads? But when the challenges come, they're the first to hit the door. Then you have robotic faith. Always need a sign. They need some sort of miracle. They need some sort of encouragement. They can't move on. They're just robotic. They go until when they're just winding out. And then we have the spiritual unleavened bread faith. It's a faith that does not matter what happens, no matter how much challenges, no matter how much setback, no matter what people say, it perseveres. It perseveres until it achieves its ultimate goal. The doctrinal faith is only concerned about doctrines. They are a type of person that they spend hours explaining doctrine. Just explaining doctrine. And some of us who don't have that expertise, we with our small faith, we feel so small around them because they are so eloquent in expounding the doctrines. And you are saying, oh, I can't do that. But you have something that is much stronger than them, faith. Faith that you are developing, faith that you're working on to maturity. Faith is not an overnight thing, and it does not depend on how much doctrine you know. You can know all the 37 doctrine of the church that cannot save you. It is your faith that will save you when the difficult times come. And you can hold on to Jesus Christ and say, no matter what, I am going to make it. It's a type of faith that put oil in the lamp when the place is dark. Is a type of faith that when everything is falling apart, it stands assured. The rich young ruler in Matthew 19:19 demonstrate these types of faith. Don't steal, don't murder, don't commit adultery. He is excellent. He said in verse 20, what am I lacking, Jesus? What am I lacking? In his mind, he lacks nothing. He's perfect. He has accomplished his goal. He should be in the kingdom of God by now. And that's what he was saying to Jesus. He was saying to Jesus, I am perfect because I'm keeping the law. The law cannot save us, although we need the law to point us to Christ and to make it into the kingdom, because none of us drive on the right side of the road. We Jamaicans have a problem. Right. So we don't come here. We don't come from a country that we drive on the right side of the road and then come to a country that drives on the left side and then drives on the right side. It's not going to work. It's not going to work. You're not perfect. This rich young ruler saying to God that he's perfect. That's why Jesus said, why do you call me good? Only God is good. He was comparing himself to God himself because he thought he was refining the laws. And that is what he wants. That is his accomplishment. Jesus gave him a simple task. Sell what you have and follow me. That is a simple thing. But guess what? He was so wrapped up in his wealth. He was so wrapped up in his head knowledge of knowing the laws that he had that as a God before Jesus, as the God before God. That was his God. And the Ten Commandments said, you shall have no other gods before me. His wealth become his God. Sometimes we allow these things of our life to become the God in our life and replace in the God that saves. Look deeply, see if we have that type of faith, the rich young ruler faith, that only depends on himself and think that he has arrived because he's not committing adultery, he's not committing fornication or anything. He believes that he's arrived and perfect. We are not perfect. We need Christ to justify us by our faith in him. We need Christ. The robotic faith is a type of Gibeon's faith. Gibeon is one of the guys in the Bible that cracks me up the most. He asks for signs over and over and over again. God gives him a sign. He asks for another sign. This is how the robotic faith works. Always want something to stimulate it. For the next few minutes, for the next few years, for the next few hours. It's like some some sort of relationship people are in, always depending on the stimuli for the happiness in the relationship. Always depend on that. They depend so much on the person to stimulate them so that they feel comfortable, so that they feel that they can go on. We must move away from this robotic faith that Gideon and Moses had. We have to move in the true faith, the true spiritual unleavened bread faith. And that's what we all keep today. We have kept for the last 7 days. That's what we have sweat. We have taken our time. So don't just take off the time. Don't just clean out your house. Don't just stay away from unleavened bread. Allow it to mean something in your life. Allow it to mean something. Don't be ritualistic in what you do. Make it be purposeful and meaningful, impactful. Because these days that you are gone, you have gone through, is the days that you have built up, you are building up your faith. Amen. You think it is easy to keep the days of unleavened bread in America? It's not. In Jamaica, the next corner you go, you can find a food shop. Yes. In the here, Subway, McDonald's, Burger King, everything, KFC. You can't drive too far without seeing one of those. I started to develop the discipline. I start 2 weeks before to just develop the discipline of keeping the days of unleavened bread. Faith is a discipline that we have to learn. Amen. It's a discipline that we have to learn if we want to see it true. Many of us in the church just move from one sign to the next, one stimuli to the next, hoping that these signs, these stimuli can help us physiologically. They can't. They're just a moment in time that's just gonna fade. When you come to that point where you feel down and lonely and out, what are you going to do? If you don't have any money in the bank, you cannot make a withdrawal. If you have not made deposit in the faith bank, you cannot withdraw when you need it. You have to start making that deposit today. Judges 6:16, the Lord answered, I will be with you, and you will strike down the Amorites, leaving none alive. Gideon replied, if now I have found favor in your eyes, give me a sign, and it is really you. The first place, God called you, brother. Oh, sorry, God called you. God called you. What are you talking about having favor? He favored you the fact that he called you. Yes. If he didn't favor you, he'd have left you. He favors all of us in this room. And that's why, because through this calling, we have to strengthen the foundation of our faith. This is our faith that is going to be rocked in the last days. Jesus said, will I find faith when I return? Will I find my elect faithful when I return? It's very deep by Jesus. Will we stand looking over into the kingdom of God? Are we going to be standing looking away from it? Looking away from it. Watch yourself. Develop and strengthen that faith within you. When we do not know what type of faith we have, we're like a fish swimming in a pond. That we believe that we are the biggest fish in the pond. Until another fish come and swallow us. We said, oh, I am not the biggest fish. But you're already being swallowed. Sometimes we believe that we are the biggest fish in the pond until our problems come and swallow us up. And we end up leaving the church. Our problems become so overwhelming that we cannot move on. That we are just stuck. That we are lifeless. And you know why we come to that point? Because we're never spending the time developing the faith that we need for that day. Every day for you is a test. I said, every day is a gift. But every day you have lived out is a blessing.
Yes.
We cannot allow that blessing to just pass off and not make use of it. Today is a blessing for all of us. We have to make it make sense. Moses on Exodus 4:15. But Moses said, "Pardon me, Lord. Pardon your servant, Lord. Please send someone else." Sometimes some of us are in the church. We have abilities. We have talent. But what we do, we sit on it. We sit on it. We don't use it to build the church because what we want God to use someone else. When it is you he wants to use. Because the thing about it, all of us are unique in how we are. The way I am is not where Elder George is. The way Elder George is not the way Elder Wright is. All of us are different. All of us carry something to the flock. We all bring something to the fold. And God calls us not to be a next phone on the bench or a next seat, but he calls us to make an impact on each other's life. But if we're not living that faithful life, if we're living that robotic faith, we're not going to see that because we want God to use somebody else. We want God. I can't deal with it. I can't take the challenges. People are going to say things about me. People are going to use me. So what? We have been using Jesus Christ himself. Have Jesus Christ complained about us using him? He has never complained about it. He said, "I love you, I love you, I love you. I gave my life for you." So we have to move from the robotic faith of just needing signs, just needing that stimuli to move from one place to the next. Matthew 25, and I just read verse 25. It was with the parable with the talents. These parables that we get in the Bible, read them through and analyze them carefully. They are talking about us. Because if we compare that person who gets a gift or got a gift to give to the church, and that person sits on that gift, it's as if they have I want to give it a nice term, but because I know I'm not going to give it a nice term, I'm not going to say it. They need to just get up and just start doing something. Even if it's contributing to a Bible study, taking up the drink. I remember when I first came in the church, the first thing I did was serve drink. Serve the speaker water, and I came around and I give persons water. Then other things start to happen. I never came in the church as a talented, bright guy, good speak. When I used to speak, Janelle can tell you, when I used to speak, I was sweating. This podium would be all rocking all over the place. I was stumbling over my words. I couldn't even pronounce things properly. I have to go to Brother Lewis. Sometime when you guys see me in the corner with Sir Lewis, I thought, Sir Lewis was teaching me how to read. Sir Lewis was starting me how to put presentations together. And these are the talents that he has given me that I've used today. Sir Bowen showed me things, but he taught me what I am doing today. Yes, it was embarrassing because I know what people were thinking. But guess what? That's a your business. And what I am doing is me and God's business. That's why I'm here today before you. Because I exercise that faith despite of what I knew in my mind people would be saying of me. Yes, I'm not bright, but so what? God used the simplest things of the world to bring his message to the world. Never look on where you are. Look on how God sees you. God sees you more powerful than how you see yourself. But if we just look on ourselves with a robotic faith, we'll never develop that strong faith in God. And now we come to the spiritual unleavened bread faith. That's a faith that no matter what, you cannot stop it. It's like an energy that's an unstoppable energy. You can't break its will. Fire, nothing can stop it. It has this enthusiasm that and perseverance that whatever you put in your way, it's going to find a way, either over it, around it, under it, or some way, it is going to persevere until it reaches where it's going. Matthew 15:25 is about the Canaanite woman. The Canaanite woman showed real faith. Better than Israel. Remember, don't look at her life simply. No. When you read the book of Judges, even Gibeon was sent to kill the Canaanites. Yeah. She had to overcome the past of that, of knowing these Jews killed her ancestors. She had to overcome the disciple of Christ telling Jesus to run her away. She had to overcome Jesus calling her a dog. Many of us here today, if the speaker or anyone call us something like that, where's the nearest exit? We gone. We leave church. Whenever you're insulted within the church, that is the time you build up that courage. Because the thing about it, when you leave, it's easier for you to leave wherever you have gone. Yeah. Andy and I have been in the church for a long time, and also Janelle and others. We have seen this rolling stone, gather no mask type of living. They move from one church to the next, trying to find a perfect church, but they have not read the Bible. They have not read it properly, because their faith was doctrinal. Their faith was spitting off the amount of doctrine they could learn. They have never developed that strong will that the Canaanite woman developed. Perseverance, tenacity, faith calls for those things. Tenacity and perseverance. We cannot let go. Jesus, the Savior of the world, called this woman a dog. Yes. Andy, yes. She said, even the dog eat the crumbs, yes, from the master's table. Yes. Jesus Christ of Nazareth, give me what I want. That is the type of faith that we should develop in ourselves. We should spend the time within ourselves to cultivate that faith. To cultivate that nature of faith. That no matter what Janelle say to me, I can still come through that door. Sabbath after Sabbath. Janelle never say anything to me though. Let me tell you that. I can come through that door week after week, Sabbath after Sabbath. Look at Janelle, shake her and hug her. And still have a choir practice with her. We will never find a perfect church. Amen. But we will always find perfect faith in Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. What do you want to achieve? Hebrews 11 verse 2. This is what the ancients were commended for. Their tenacity in believing in Jesus. In Jesus. Let us show that tenacity, that perseverance, that strength, that courage to make it to the kingdom of God. Amen. Oh. I'm finished.
Amen. Amen. Tenacity. Tenacity. Amen, Bridget.
Didn't disappoint you.
You didn't disappoint. lose all their guilty stains. Lose all their guilty stains. Lose all their guilty stains. Amen, Brother Solomon. No, I'm not another member of the choir. But at this time, I'm going to invite another member of the choir. I wish you to put your hands together for our dear sister Janelle, as she will now come with the second special item.
Happy Sabbath, everyone. So good to be here with you all today. This song is just reflective on the unleavened bread period, and that expresses the love that Jesus has for all of us.
Thank you, Sister Jana. Indeed, that was beautiful. You hear of brotherly love, till death do us part kind of love, but there is no greater love than God's love. No greater love. Thank you, Sister Jana. At this time, we know there are certain appointed times that we're not supposed to appear before the Lord empty-handed. So at this time, we'll have our dear friend and our brother, Brother Hopeton Anderson, with today's offertory.
Thank you so much, brother. Brother Solomon, you've grown in every way.
Right?
You know, you were so controlled. I'm telling you, it's marvelous. I'm so thrilled. You've spoken at me. And if you don't speak at me, something is wrong with your presentation, because it means I've fallen short, and you've shown me up. So you've spoken at me. And that's what you must always do, speak at us. Yes, not just to us, like you're just giving information. Pull us up. Let us pull up our socks. See how far I'm going with the language. So today, we know, I'm not going to spend more than 5 minutes because we have been so blessed. Today is the day when we ought to give unto the Lord, unto the Lord's work, because God doesn't want money, because all the riches of the earth belong to him. So we know this is the seventh day of unleavened bread. And we go straight to Leviticus 23, verse 5. I won't be long. Leviticus 23, verse 5. And, you know, everybody knows about Leviticus 23. It's not that we don't know it. It's that we must be reminded. We must remind ourselves and about the giving an offering unto the Lord, taking an offering to the Lord. Leviticus 20. I'm reading from the Jerusalem Bible, which is a Roman Catholic Bible. It's a very good Bible. Excellent Bible. Excellent Bible. My mother gave it to me in 1984 for my birthday present. Yes. Yeah. My mother endured to the end. Thank God for that. Here, verse 5 says, the 14th day of the first month, between the two evenings, is the Passover of Yahweh. And the 15th day of the same month is the feast of unleavened bread. For Yahweh, unleavened bread for Yahweh. For 7 days, you shall eat bread without leaven. On the first day, you are to hold a sacred assembly. You must do no heavy work. So simple language, no heavy work. For 7 days, you shall offer a burnt offering to Yahweh. The seventh day is to be a day of sacred assembly. You must do no work. And that's what we're doing today. We're worshiping. We are commemorating. We are, praising the Lord. Let's go to Deuteronomy 16, 1 to 8. I'm at 15. 16, 1 to 8. 16. The Passover and unleavened bread. Observe the month of Abib, and celebrate the Passover for Yahweh your God, because it was in the month of Abib that Yahweh your God brought you out of Egypt by night. You must sacrifice the Passover from your flock or herd for Yahweh your God in the place where Yahweh chooses to give his name. To give his name a home. You must not eat leavened bread with this. For 7 days, you must eat it with unleavened bread. The bread of emergency. That's another name for it. The bread of emergency. For it was in great haste
that you came out of the land of Egypt. So you will remember all the days of your life, the day you came out of the land of Egypt. For 7 days, no leaven must be found in any house throughout your territory, nor must any of the meat that you sacrifice in the evening of the first day be kept overnight until morning. You may not sacrifice the Passover in any of the towns that Yahweh your God gives you, but only in the place where Yahweh your God chooses to give his name a house or a home. There you must sacrifice the Passover in the evening at sunset, at the hour at which you came out of Egypt. You must cook it and eat it in the place Yahweh your God chooses. And in the morning, you are to return and go to your tents. This is just before they were prepared to leave, because they left at night. For 6 days, you shall eat unleavened bread. On the seventh day, there shall be an assembly for Yahweh your God, and you must do no work. God is speaking here. He spoke then, and he's also speaking today through his word. And Leviticus 23:5. I have here 5-8, but I just read 5, so I won't go back to that. But in Deuteronomy 16, we'll go back to Deuteronomy. Deuteronomy 16, verse 16. That's where I am, Deuteronomy 16. But I'm going to verse 16 this time, and hear what it says. Three times a year, or three seasons a year, your menfolk are to appear before Yahweh your God in the place he chooses. Not only menfolk, but women too. But God knows why he says menfolk. At the feast of unleavened bread, at the feast of weeks, at the feast of tabernacles, no one must appear before Yahweh empty-handed, but every man must give what he can in proportion to the blessing that Yahweh your God gives you.
Amen.
Now that's another commandment. There are so many commandments. So at this time, we are going to, yes, okay. We're going to take up the offering, and if anyone would like a receipt for tax purposes at the end of the year, please write your name, address, and amount of offering on the envelope. And I also speak to those online. What's the address again, Elder? Please?
CGINY.org/donate.
Yes. You can send your offerings to CGINY.org. Yes, slash donate. For people online. CGINY.org/donate. And if you need a receipt for tax purposes, you may put your name and address, etc.
And it's very, good. Very simple to do.
Yes.
Very
and our elder is saying it's very simple to do. Very simple to do. So at this moment, we're going to take up the offering. Brother John, will you please? So let us give, and we're doing that, giving according to how the Lord has blessed us. Thank the Lord for that. I'm so blessed. I've been so blessed by the sermonette. I've been so blessed by the songs. I'm really thrilled. So happy to listen to the songs. I have it on record. I have the songs on record. I also have the sermonette on record. Please. One more song.
Father, thank you for the opportunity for all of us to ensure that the work, especially at this time, the end time as it's known, that the offerings that we collect today will play a part, Father, in the work continuing in the days and times ahead. Bless those that have contributed, Father, here in person and for those online, that their blessings from you, Father, will reach out to each and every one, their hearts, their minds, that they have contributed to the continuing of your holy, righteous work. Yes. Bless each giver that, Father, the words we hear, the offerings we collect, will be enough to carry us forward and carry us through wanting more spiritual food as we grow in faith. Bless our proceedings, we ask, and we ask it all in Christ's holy, righteous name. Amen.
Thank you, Brother John. Brother Taron, please come forward. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Brother Hopeton. At this time, we'll now invite to the podium the CGI Choir. Mic check.
Happy Sabbath,
everyone. Happy Sabbath. Can you put it on the other side?
Thank you, CGINY Choir. Have you been filled?
Yes.
Oh, that means you don't want anything more? Do you want more, brethren?
Yes.
Indeed, we have the most wonderful meal for you right now.
Yes.
So I now invite our dear elder and our dear brother, Elder Wright, with today's sermon. Happy Sabbath, Church of God. May grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father and the Messiah Jesus be yours in abundance. And as the song says, may the work we do speaks for us. This afternoon, I want us to go to the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 5 as I start. I say welcome back, my brother. Happy to have you. 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 7 to 8. And I read, cleanse out the old leaven that you may be a new lump, as you really are unleavened. For Christ, our Passover lamb, has been sacrificed. Let us therefore celebrate the festival, not with the old leaven, the leaven of malice and evil, but with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. Sincerity and truth. I did not have a message like this in mind. I wanted to do something adventurous. So I was considering the 3 days and 3 nights.
That is a very adventurous doctrine. And that doctrine it typifies a lot of things. Because once you break the stand of that doctrine, you off. So any new doctrine you come and it don't fit in with the 3-day and 3-night. The first time I hear the doctrine of the morning starting the day, I said, no, that is going to throw the 3-day and 3-night off. And we definitely need all the doctrines to harmonize for it to be true. But Elder George came up last Sabbath, and he did a brilliant summary of the 3-day, 3-night. And so I say I have to find something else. I had to reroute. But that was very good, Elder George. And thanks, Deacon Solomon, for your message. A very profound message indeed. But the 3-day and 3-night, it goes very far, very wide, and very deep within the construct of doctrines, as I said. But this afternoon, let me carry us on a journey, and I'm going to read again from 1 Corinthians chapter 5 to start the journey properly. It says again, cleanse out the old leaven, that you may be a new lump. As you really are unleavened, for Christ, our Passover lamb, has been sacrificed. Let us therefore celebrate the festival not with the old leaven, the leaven of malice and evil, but with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. And I want us to take a minute and think about what was just said. It's on the screen right now, displayed. So read it over back and take a minute and reflect on what those two verses is saying to us. Reflect. You're supposed to remove and replace. Okay, I'm not going to do a minute according to the clock, so I guess everyone's supposed to have an idea of where we're going. So let me ask, what did we accomplish over these 7 days based on the instruction given in 1 Corinthians chapter 5? What did you accomplish by doing that? We gather here this afternoon. Let us look in our lives according to what those two verses said. Which old leaven have you gotten rid of? And that is a question you need to answer within self. If you had no leaven to be removed, to God be the glory. Because over the years you have been observing the feast, you are now cleansed. So to God be the glory for you. But I want to speak to us who had remaining leaven that we need to work on, need to be removed. We clean out the house, the car, our office space, and we eat the bread for 7 days. We show up at church the first day, and we are here on the 7th. What if I should do a CT scan? And the CT scan is so advanced now that it can reveal the things that is in the heart of us. What would the CT scan reveal about Richard Anthony Wright? Would we be pleased, just as all we come to the Sabbath the first day, come to the feast the first day and the seventh, joyfully, happily, obeying the commands? Would you sit here and look at the screen as Solomon say, and be happy with what is revealed from that scan? What would that scan reveal to us or to you? The leaven of malice and evil, mm-hmm. or the unleavened bread of sincerity
and truth.
And truth.
Yes, sir.
Because it is easy for us to do the outward, to go with the flow. But the true sense of the feast is for our inward inspection.
That's right.
I cannot do it for you, Otan. You cannot do it for me. The greatest enemy of communication, the scripture just mentioned, and it's malice. We cannot have a situation dealing with, and one party is keeping malice or keeping information from the discussion.
Right on.
So when he said you should get rid of malice, and if you should really search out the other one, which is evil, you have a lot of work. We have a lot of work. When it comes to the things that is needed for us to be unleavened. You cannot tell if an apple is good by looking at it. Your judgment might be wrong. You have to get inside that apple to know if it is a good apple. Well, shine and pretty. Red. And as you bite, you have to be running from worm. That's a bad apple, but it's very attractive on the outside. You have to get on the inside to know if the apple is good. And it's the same for us. The CT scan is a daily thing for God,
amen,
for us. What's the intent behind what we do? What's the intent behind what we say? 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 3 to 4 says, do not let your adornment be external, the braiding of hair and the putting on of gold jewelry or the clothing you wear. Verse 4, but let your adornment be the hidden person of the heart with the imperishable beauty of a gentle and quiet spirit. It didn't stop there, which in God's sight is very precious. Just like 1 Corinthians chapter 5, 1 Peter here is giving us another instruction in which we need to have our frame of thinking to coordinate with our way of acting. Amen?
Yes. Amen.
Proverbs 31 and verse 30 says, as we look at the imperishable beauty of a gentle and quiet spirit, Proverbs 31 and verse 30 says, charm is deceitful and beauty fades, but a woman who fears the Lord will be praised.
Yes, sir.
Proverbs chapter 21 and verse 19. Proverbs 21 and verse 9 first. It is better to live in the corner of the housetop than in a house shared with a quarrelsome wife. Proverbs chapter 21 and verse 19. It is better to live in the desert land than with a quarrelsome and fretful woman. And I know the feminists will basically like to jump on these scriptures to say the Bible is putting down women. But let us keep in mind that not only in Proverbs, but in your Bible, some of these references are unisex. So even though it makes reference of a quarrelsome wife, it is sad to say that you have some quarrelsome husband. Just as you can reflect on a quarrelsome wife, it is the same about some men. Sad to say. But as we continue to strive to live an unleavened life, let the goal be one in which we strive to be beautiful in the gentle and quiet spirit which God is very pleased. If I invest my time and energy to achieve this, how will it affect my relationship with God, my service to the church, my family and friends? When we look at investment, we would imagine what we could do with $1 million. Yes. How much relief that million would bring to your life. How much relief $1 million would do for you, your family, and your friends. Let us look with that same great expectation of relieving the suffering of friends and family by taking on to ourselves the imperishable beauty of a gentle and quiet spirit. Just as $1 million would be so much benefit, just reflect a quiet and gentle spirit, how much that would worth. At work, at home, at church, and sad to say, but it will help even us in person. A gentle and a quiet spirit will help you from a lot of frustration. Because we get edgy for things that is unnecessary when we don't have a quiet and gentle spirit.
Yes, sir.
Remember when Christ offered the burden to us, he said, because I am gentle. So if you are of Christ, you have been taken in Christ for 7 days as the feast pitcher. Where is that spirit of gentleness? Where is that quiet spirit? And don't misunderstand the gentle and quiet spirit, because if you look at the life of Christ, when it's time to set things in order, that same gentle and quiet spirit get things done in order. Yes. But it's not to say you are going to play the fool and be run over by being gentle and quiet. Know where you stand. Proverbs chapter 17 and verse 22 said, a joyful heart is good medicine, but a cross spirit dries up the bones. Most of us that say we are suffering from arthritis, it's not arthritis. It's a crushed spirit that you keep walking around with all the days of your life start affecting you. It's a serious thing to be walking around grumpy. You don't only carry down yourself, you carry down those who are around you. Find the time to develop not only the mind, but that which Christ has given us the instruction to do, walk in his way. Don't just look good on the outside with only skin deep righteousness. And everybody know how thick their skin is. And if that's the depth of your righteousness that you are taking in from Christ, it's not profitable. Be intentional about the changes that you need as you go through these days. We have a common statement that we often apply to ourselves to say, I am very thin skinned. And it is not a bad thing to be thin skinned. What you are saying, no, brother. I see that look, brother. But let me straighten out what I'm saying. Lot was commended for being thin skinned. Second Peter chapter 2 and verse 7. And he delivered righteous Lot, oppressed with the lustful behaviors of lawlessness. Lot did not have any accommodation for lawlessness. He was thin-skinned. Are you thin-skinned for the ignorance that exists within you? Do you find yourself when the Spirit corrects you? You should approach the situation different, Brother Solomon.
Yes, sir.
It's a sense where we need to reflect and repent. Be thin-skinned for the righteousness of God, not for the righteousness of self. Because most of the time when we find ourselves being thin-skinned, it's for our benefits.
Yes.
My wife didn't do what I want her to do. So I'm very upset now, no talking, no doing what she asks, because I'm in my own righteousness. I'm seeking my own way. But if we are thin-skinned for God's will, not being arrogant, this is the right way to move forward. The days of unleavened bread is given to help us develop that imperishable beauty of a gentle and quiet spirit.
Amen.
And I will not shortchange the scripture, which, in God's sight, is very precious. The feast days are boot camp, gearing towards making us better persons. I repeat that. The feast days are boot camps, gearing towards making us better persons. Or you can call it rehab from sin. So each year we automatically get checked into rehab for the sin thing. Starting with the days of unleavened bread,
right on.
We check into rehab just because of sin.
Yeah. Yes.
But what is your attitude when you get checked out? Most of the time, we check ourselves out. Before the time.
Yeah.
Right on point. This is the seventh day, and everybody's not here. Before the process is through, you check yourself out. You are in rehab to correct things that need to be corrected. But as we know, the addiction state is, the minute I get the chance out of here, I'm going to fly. For those who are addicted to drugs, they're going to get back high if they get the chance to.
Yes, sir.
But how different is it with us as the days of unleavened bread? The seventh day is over. There is this new doctrine, and I was asked to address it, and I declined from doing so, because I think this message is far more important, in which they are now saying it is not even necessary to take out the leaven out of your house, because there's no scripture referring to leaven as sin. And I said, well, basically, the Lord himself set forth the command, and we are to follow, and it's as simple as that for me. I will continue to take out leaven until I die.
Thank you.
But I said that to say this. Obedience to God is far more important than anything we can do to achieve anything in life.
Right on. Yes.
What is it you going to put either to the level of your salvation or above? Because the sad thing when you really look at it, you know, when you make the decision to do otherwise, you are showing it to be more important. And if you can bring yourself to that point, knowing the truth and doing otherwise, you find a different God.
Yes, sir.
The world as we know is getting worse. So we can say they are getting better at what they are doing. Because as the world gets worse, you realize that this is what they've been doing all along. So they are getting better at it. How much better are you in God? Are we getting better at it? How much unleavened are you this year than last year? And it should not be a part thing according to the scripture, because the scripture says you are now unleavened because of what Christ did.
Yes.
But according to the ritual, we realize that we still need to remove some things. How closer are you this year than last year? And I can use an example that you just see right here with the choir. Solomon mentioned this in his message. But Dolisha took up playing the guitar as a means by which she improved her service to the church. And in doing so, we have a choir singing with Dolisha. That in itself is the true example of not only taking in the leaven, but as Solomon alluded to the talents, her talent has grown the church in singing to the Lord. We are given gifts to glorify God, not to come here and sit on it as the one that received the one. And until we come to that recognition, we are losing the main reason for us being here.
Yes.
Did my relationship improve with my wife, my husband, my children, the family, co-workers over these 7 days? What has changed? Only your diet? It is important that even as our diet change, our spiritual growth also may change. We should be always improving ourselves, as the scripture says. Grow in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior. Again, I allude to Solomon's message. Not just the head knowledge of knowing the doctrine, but the knowledge of acting as Jesus would. Yes. Cleaning the house, car, office space, showing up for the first day of on the seventh day, not eating anything with leaven, but eating the unleavened bread, you did well. So if you achieve that without, as we normally have followed throughout the years, everybody would come and testify, say, I eat a patty accidentally. Yeah. I add a burger accidentally. No one here?
Nope.
So you are doing well on that side. And that is really good. But did we achieve all that but neglect the weightier matter?
Amen.
Did we achieve that now and neglect the weightier matters? Matthew chapter 23 and verse 23. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you tithe mint and dill and cumin, and have neglected the weightier matter of the law, justice and mercy and faithfulness. Those you are to have done without neglecting the others.
Right on.
And from this, I will take the title of the message. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites. The title of the sermon is, Am I a Hypocrite? Do I come here after here, observing the Sabbath, observing the feast days, but yet there is no change in me? This was the biggest problem Christ had with the scribes and the Pharisees. The ritual is supposed to affect your life in how you live. The real victory for Christ over Satan occurs during the days of unleavened bread.
Yes.
And throughout Israel history, most of the victory that Israel have in their history is during the days of unleavened bread.
Yes.
Significant. Christ's greatest victory came at the resurrection. Christ's greatest victory came at the resurrection. 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse 14 says, and if Christ has not been risen, then our preaching is in vain,
yes,
and your faith is in vain.
Yes.
Matthew chapter 28 and verse 18, then Jesus came up and told them, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Could we be guilty of celebrating the feast with all leaven? Could we be guilty of celebrating the feast with all leaven? It's a time of victory. As the famous song in Jamaica says, hold on for your victory. Christian, hold on for your victory. Now is the time to claim that victory. If we have not yet take all of the weightier matters, we are no different from the scribes and the Pharisees. Please go with me to the book of Luke chapter 12, verses 1 to 3. Luke chapter 12, verses 1 to 3. In the meantime, when so many thousands of the people had gathered together that they were trampling one another, he began to say to his disciples, "Beware of the leaven of the Pharisees, which is hypocrisy." Nothing is covered up that will not be revealed, or hidden that will not be known. Therefore, whatever you have said in the dark shall be heard in the light, and what you have whispered in private rooms shall be proclaimed on the housetop.
Yes, sir.
This is a clear warning for us as believers, because our clear assessment of do's and don'ts is in the scripture. And the Pharisees are used as an example of things that we should not do. But I'm going to close showing you that the scribes and Pharisees have things that you should be doing. Everyone might have a moment of hypocrisy some point in time. You being a hypocrite. Me being a hypocrite. At some point in time. But the danger is living the life of a hypocrite.
Yes.
And if you find yourself being a hypocrite, stop it. A hypocrite is one who is never genuine but always play acting. Always play acting. Get ready for the show. If you are one of them who like Broadway, as my wife loves to go.
She's not there.
When you go to those plays, these people are ready for the character they play, and they play it well.
Ready, ready.
Our dear sister Rose gave us a perfect play at the feast with about 7 different persons. 7 different personalities. That is us at the best. Among each other, among workers, but the true test is the CT scan. God knows that you are playing around. And as the scripture just said, whatever is spoken in the darkness or in the, it shall be revealed. Hypocrites inhabit every walk of life, trying to impress others in an attempt to hide who they really are. In the Christian life, a hypocrite is someone who tries to appear more spiritual than he or she really is. Such a person knows that he or she is pretending and hope not to be found out. Jesus warned his disciple of this spiritual pitfall. But guess what? Human nature drives us to want people to like and admire us. And it is so easy for that to be a part of us. We don't want to be left out. So to be a part of the crowd, you have to do what the crowd like or what the crowd is doing. But that's human nature, as I said. We easily surrender to human nature by giving in to the temptation either to gain popularity by pleasing the crowd or to avoid trouble by pleasing those who set over us. It's a test. As much as we would agree that we hate hypocrites, most of the time that character help people to fit in.
Yes.
But it's a test unto us not to just fit in, but to be what God has called us to be.
Right on.
What is the basic cause of hypocrisy? Luke chapter 12, verse 4 to 7. Jesus mentioned fear 5 times in these verses, teaching that the basic cause of hypocrisy is fear of man. People will do almost anything to avoid embarrassment or harm. When we are afraid of what others may say or do to us, we try to impress them by gaining their approval. And our human nature will stoop to deception to accomplish this purpose. So even ourselves, we deceive, being a hypocrite. It's a nature of the flesh we should resist. Sadly, we become more concerned about reputation than character. As the word, the days, as we proceed in acknowledge and observing them, it's supposed to change your character. Not just looking for our title to be changed, but our character.
Amen.
Don't hide under the disguise of just being a Christian. What people think about us is more important than what God himself wants of us. The fear of men always brings a snare. And I repeat that. The fear of man always produces a snare.
Yes.
Proverbs chapter 29, verses 25 to 27. The fear of man lays a snare, but whoever trusts in God is safe.
Amen.
Many seek the face of a ruler, but it is from the Lord that a man gets justice. Verse 27, an unjust man is an abomination to the righteous, but the one whose ways is straight is an abomination to the wicked. Don't be snared by man. How can we avoid the pitfall of hypocrisy? If we examine Luke chapter 12, verse 1 to 3, Jesus compared hypocrisy to leaven, which symbolized sin. Like leaven, hypocrisy begins small, but grows quickly and quietly. Before you know it, it has taken over who you are. It becomes natural to you how you deal with people to have your way and to have things done. As it does, it infects the whole person and eventually those who are around him. You ever see a corrupt leader? Everybody in the gang has to be corrupt in order for it to work right. Right. So in other words, once you allow yourself in that frame of mind, those who are around you also have to be in that frame of mind. Birds of a feather. When a person is puffed up with pride, hypocrisy flourishes and character diminishes. Being puffed up with pride, you will do anything to get your way. And as the saying goes, anything. Anything as in anything. 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 6. I applied all these things to myself and Apollos for your benefit, brothers. that you may learn by us not to go beyond what is written, that none of you may be puffed up in favor of one against the other. Hypocrisy will join you with others against others. The oneness that Christ desires for his church cannot be achieved through a hypocrite. So if you are on this journey to build the church of God, let not hypocrisy be a part of your character. Hypocrisy, like sin, must be stopped before the underlying pride has an opportunity to spread. The longer we wait to deal with it, the worse it gets. Nothing can really be hidden from the one who will reward us, which make hypocrisy foolish. Yes. You can't hide from God. With all that we are doing, we cannot disguise it from God. Amen. And he's the one that's going to reward us. Yes. Not who we are trying to impress. Yes. It's a futile act. Mark chapter 4, verse 22 to 23. For nothing is hidden except to be made manifest, nor is anything secret except to come to light. If anyone has an ear to hear, let him hear. Yes. It's time for us to stop pretending. In the eyes of God, a true heart in showing to God our diligence towards the work and towards our own salvation is all we are called to do. Not to build another empire. How can we overcome hypocrisy if we are a hypocrite? The remedy for hypocrisy is reverent fear of God. The fear that conquers all other fears. Because the person who truly fears God fears nothing else. The person who truly fears God fears nothing else. The Apostle John teaches that the love of God casts out all fear. 1 John 4, verse 18. Thus, we can ignore the negative things people say and do and live a life for God. With God standing by us, why should we fear the criticism of others? They can do no more than kill the body, but God can destroy both body and soul.
Yes, sir.
Since Christ is the ultimate judge and eternal rewarder, it is logical to put the fear of God in everything we do. Yeah. Fearing man often results in denying Christ, bringing severe consequences. We need to have the fear of God and not of man. Yeah. A Christian can avoid persecution by denying that he is Jesus' disciple. But the eternal cost of doing so is far worse than persecution that you sought to avoid. The opposite of denying Christ is to confess him before others that he is the Lord of Lords and the King of Kings.
Yes.
Let your life be a witness, not just verbally. Not just verbally. A Christian living any other way is a hypocrite. If we are not striving to fulfill what unleavened bread represents, which is taken in Christ,
yes,
we are fooling ourselves. If we don't achieve anything over the time of observing the 7 days, we are wasting our time.
Yes, sir.
And in coming here, in doing all the physical rituals, we are being hypocritical. Because if we are not putting on a show, we should achieve something. If you go to the doctor, you realize they give you medicine for a period of time. Why? Over that period, you're supposed to have change. You're supposed to get better. The doctor, of all doctor, know your condition in sin. This is why we have these periods of medicating. Are we getting better? Or, like some of us would do when we get our medication, is put them aside. I not take no more medic, don't pill. Scared of side effects. Yes. Because the side effects that we really face in life is some of the so-called pleasures in the world. And because of those side effects, we will not move forward in medicating ourselves. Put the pill aside. Put unleavened bread aside because I need to make some money. No side effects. Because the side effects in keeping unleavened bread now, I am going to lose out on $2,000. That's a crazy side effect. But we need to make that $2,000 instead of going to hear Richie talk about me a hypocrite. It's far more worth it to make my $2,000. There is no shame in suffering for being a Christian. If we suffer for righteousness, we should keep on doing what is right, trusting our life to our Creator, because He will never fail. 1 Peter chapter 4, as I come down, verse 14 to 19. If you are insulted for the name of Christ, you are blessed. I've never heard this in the wealth preaching. If you are insulted for the name of Christ, you are blessed.
Yes, amen.
So who want insult, run them down. Because blessing and run me down is one of the most popular songs, you know.
Yes.
Blessing and run me down. Who want insult, run them down? It's a blessing to be insulted. For you to be insulted, it's a blessing, my dear sister Lisa. You want an insult now?
Yes, please. Yeah. Sure. Give us
one. Huh? Because the Spirit of glory and of God rests upon you. When the insult is from outside, it is not as bad as when it is from inside the church.
Yes.
So as much as we are supposed to be welcoming insult, when it comes from inside, it is not so good. It is harder to withstand when a brother or a sister insult you. And so the word says, whoever insulting, wherever the insult is coming from, keep strong. Verse 15. But let none of you suffer as a murderer or a thief or an evildoer or a meddler. Hope none of us are not in that category. Yet, verse 16 says, yet if anyone suffers as a Christian, let him not be ashamed, but let him glorify God in that name. For it is time for judgment to begin at the house of God. And if it begins with us, what will be the outcome for those who do not obey the gospel of God? We are being judged right now, not the world. Take heed how you treat each other. as I said, the CT scan is a daily routine for God.
Yes.
Take heed how you deal with your wife. Take heed how you deal with your husband. The scan is always on. We are open before God.
Yes.
And being a hypocrite among people and among yourself, it is useless. God knows everything. Philippians chapter 2, verse 3 to 5. Do not act out of selfish ambition or conceit, but with humility, think of others as being better than yourself.
Yes, sir.
Do not be concerned about your own interests, but also be concerned about the interests of others. Have the same attitude among yourself that was also in Christ. 1 Peter chapter 4, as I close, in verse 18. And if the righteous is scarcely safe, what will become of the ungodly and the sinners? Therefore, let those who suffer according to God's will entrust their soul to the faithful Creator while doing so. As we continue to celebrate the newness of life in Christ, removing the old leaven, don't leave here and do things the way you normally do. You won't get a different result. Each time the feast days come around, and it's not something that in which we should put a pause and wait till next year for unleavened bread.
Amen.
To take out the leaven.
Amen.
Taking out leaven should be a daily thing.
Amen.
As a Christian.
Amen.
The ritual does come around to keep us focused and remind us that this is supposed to be doing, we're supposed to be doing it. It shouldn't be put on a pause. It should be a continuous attribute of us to achieve what Christ has set out to achieve. While the truth of Christ has the power to elevate, our worldly orientation can blind us, dull our mind, and pull us back into the world of sin. I will close by saying not all Pharisees are bad, and we learn not to be a hypocrite based on most of them lifestyle. But let me close with an example from Nicodemus. Pharisees of Pharisees. Nicodemus go to Jesus with his concern secretly by night. This is a Pharisee. And this is example is what I'm going to close with. By night, secretly, Nicodemus went to Christ. We are called to go to Christ in secret. We might make a show publicly, but seek the face of God in secret. Even if you are scared of the rulers, secretly seek the face of God.
Amen.
Only people who meet with Jesus in secret have a public testimony. Only people who meet in secret with Christ have a public testimony. The woman at the well.
Yes.
That was a secret meeting. And she was in the public. But I said I'm going to close with Nicodemus. I won't chat after the rest. Because the blind man, I want you to focus on what Nicodemus did. Only people who meet with Jesus in secret have a public testimony. Notice Jesus' action towards the Pharisees, which he referred to as being evil. He was still willing to listen to Nicodemus as he come to him secretly. None of us are too far from God for him to answer our prayer. Nicodemus was afraid of man, why he went to Christ in secret. But by the end of the book of John, you saw a complete change in Nicodemus. At the end of this seven-day feast, is there a change in us? He was one who helped remove Christ's body from the cross after the crucifixion for burial. A Pharisee. He wasn't a normal Pharisee. He was one of the teachers. As the discourse said, Christ asked him, a teacher, don't know this? As he inquired about born again. But Nicodemus, who went in secret, publicly, helped to remove the Christ to prepare for his burial. Are we going to come out of the closet right now with a changed heart, a changed mind, resolute to doing God's will? He went from worrying what man will think, which is self-righteousness, the same as being a hypocrite, and now was worrying about what God thinks, which is true righteousness.
Amen.
If the heart of a man can be changed from one of the most self-righteous group, what so for us? Let us strive to achieve, as we count up now to Pentecost, the imperishable beauty of a quiet and gentle spirit, which in which God is very pleased.
Thank you, Elder Wright. You know, it's funny that he mentioned that we should, have we ever had any test or any confession in terms of leaven products? Last Sabbath, we left a little late, but Celia and I, we had eight upstairs. Remember, we had unleavened bread and stuff upstairs, and cheese, unleavened cheese. Anyway, we were on our way home, right? And you know our little one, he is still formulating his sentences and stuff, so he goes, mommy, daddy, I need potty. So, you know, we hear him and we're like, oh, he's hungry, so let us stop and buy a potty. This is after Sabbath going home. Yeah. So I actually stopped and I asked him, what kind of potty do you want? So his mother was asking him, chicken or beef? Because you know how the golden crust is. Yeah. So he said, chicken. So I came out of the car and I started walking down the road. And then luckily, Sister Celia called me and he was like, Taran, what is potty? And I said, what do you mean, what is potty? And Nathan wanted the potty and she said, Taran, what is it? And I said, oh. So a lot of the times we don't, like, you know, we're going about our daily lives and we're not knowing that secretly. You said, Richard, we should meet with God in secret, but secretly the adversary is working to get you guys to slip up. So never forget that, all right, Bridget? No potty for you until you know when. But please stand with me as we have the two final hymns for today. And yes, it's another new hymn, but this one is going to be taken from the red hymn now. Hymn number 12. Anyone knows this one?
Yes.
Oh, Sister Janel, you know it? All right. Make sure everyone watch Sister Janel as she sings. Hymn number 12. I know eternal life. Amen. That's a new one for us to sing next Sabbath, Brother Richard. I'll hold you to it. Our final hymn is hymn number 119, He Lives. Hymn 119, He Lives. Standing for the closing prayer by Brother Mark Ellis.
Let us pray. Eternal Father, glorious God in heaven up above, Father, through your blessed Son, the Lamb of God, our bread of life, our all in all, Jesus Christ, we give you thanks for yet another opportunity, Father, to celebrate the seventh day of unleavened bread. Father, indeed, these festivals that you have ordained from the creation of the earth, Father, they are filled with so much lesson, Father. And Father, as we come observing the rituals, we pray, Father, that as we have heard your ministers, that we will take these words to heart, so that we will live faithfully, because this is the intention of all your words, Father, for us to be transformed into the beautiful and glorious image of your faithful and great Son. Father, help us, Father, to eat of this unleavened bread continually. We know this is the seventh day, but the days of unleavened bread never ends. Father, they never end because, Father, we cannot live without the bread of heaven. Man does not live by bread alone, but by every word. And the word is the blessed Savior, Jesus Christ.
Yes.
He is the bread we want, Father. Evermore feed us with this bread so that we will be true. We will not be hypocrites, Father, and we will Live as the faithful saints, Father, and the martyrs, Father, of the faith listed in Hebrews 11. Father, we just thank you, Father, and pray that you will bless us as we go from here. Father, bless the meal that we will partake of. Bless the fellowship. And Father, keep us in your will, because we desire you more than anything on this earth, in this life. Be with us and guide us to yourself and to our great God, Jesus Christ. We bless your name always, now and forevermore, world without end, through Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen.
Thank you, Brother Mark. Again, thank you all who ministered up here today by music or whatever it may be. And thank you for being here also. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his sweet and awesome peace. You are dismissed.